What's up, nerds and geeks? My name is OMG WTF LOLFTWBRB. Welcome back to more Total Extreme Wrestling 2016. Almost did my invasion intro there. Welcome to Total Extreme Wrestling versus the WWE, where we take the weekly events, weekly shows that WWE runs throughout the week, and book it in Total Extreme Wrestling with the exact time, exact place, pretty much identical, I'd say about 90%. As identical as I can make it be, and pretty much see how well WWE can do against the Total Extreme Wrestling booking system, if the WWE can beat Total Extreme Wrestling, or if TEW will be the one company that brings the WWE crashing down. And so far, guys, it has not been a good start. It's been quite a rough start for the WWE. We've booked two Raws so far. The go-home show from... I always say go-home show. The post-show, the Raw after WrestleMania, which really didn't do that well. And then we booked the Superstar Shake-Up, which it did all right, but still needs some improvement. And that is, of course, post-editing here. And... now we're booking our first 205 low, which, or 205 low, 205 show, which 205 honestly is, I wouldn't say it's the easiest, because honestly, none of these guys are popular, so the ratings are pretty shit, but you can't lose popularity from the show, so I guess you're good in that point, so it all works out there. Either way, let us just jump right into 205 Live. This is from last week, so I believe this would be the... I'm not even going to try to guess. It'll be on the video. You guys know what day it was. All right, so we open up the show with a solid E-rating segment here as we get a look back on the feud between the Lucha House Party, which is Kalisto, Lince Dorado, and Grand Metalik, for those who don't watch 205 Live. I know there's probably a lot of you. Taking on Hideo Itami and Akira Tozawa. This has been a feud that's been going on for, admittedly, a pretty long time. I wouldn't say a long time. About a couple months now over on 205 Live. So maybe it's a little unfair here on, you know, our 205 Live, where it's only had a week to really start. And in fact, this is the starting point for this storyline, so there's no heat behind it whatsoever as we're heading into this big match. But that's how it works sometimes. These first couple of shows are going to be mostly WWE trying to catch up with Total Extreme Wrestling. What do we have change-wise here? Oh, the turn for Hideo Itami, which... I'll wait till we get to the main event, but I am probably going to turn Hideo Itami here, because I think he's pretty certain, you know, pretty much guaranteed to be a heel right now after watching the main event. We then go to yet another solid E rating here as we get a little bit of hype for the Tornado Tag match that will take place later on tonight between Grand Metalik and Lince Dorado taking on Tozawa and Itami. And we also get a little bit of a hype about the attack from last week when Buddy Murphy attacked Cedric Alexander with the whole crowning of the Cruiserweight Championship thing. Yeah, let's move on. All right, yet another solid E rating here. This was, of course, between entrances, but I'm not able to book that as always. So solid E rating here as Dasha Fuentes, who is never rated during these segments because honestly she contributes nothing to it besides asking the question, so it's not hard. She interviews Arya Daivari and pretty much asks him why he requested this matchup against Mustafa Ali. And pretty much Daivari just, you know, talks about how all this time Mustafa was talking about how he was going to win at WrestleMania or some stuff and how he blew it. And he's pretty much going to, you know, capitalize on his opportunities or something like that. I went ahead and started a storyline between these two as well. I'm not sure if they are going to continue a story between these two or if this was just a one-off thing, but I'm pretty sure they were hinting at a story, so hopefully that works. But if not, we can always just cancel it, and who cares? All right, so finally we jump into our first match of the night, which gets a solid E rating. What's that, three E's back to back? Good God. Back to back to back. In an abysmal match, Mustafa Ali goes over Arya Daivari in 9 minutes, 52 seconds. Mustafa Ali and Arya Daivari both have, they did both get an E rating or E plus rating. No, never mind. They got different ratings, so whatever. Either way, they have great chemistry, and it showed, so I disagree. I'd like to see what this match was if they didn't have good chemistry. Apparently, this brought the crowd down, but I don't believe the crowd was ever brought up, so okay. Mustafa Ali with the in-ring performance of an E+, so he did better than Daivari, but not by much. A whole plus, because Daivari got an E. Ali and Daivari are both improving in performance, though, so at least they made the best of their night, I guess. All right. Oh, my good God. Another E rating. Is everything just going to be a solid E? Solid E once again as we get yet another recap on the Buddy Murphy attack on Cedric Alexander from last week. This time we featured Drake Maverick and Mustafa Ali because they are also featured in the little look back there. We then moved on to an E+, our first segment that does better than an E. I believe it is, at least, unless I forgot, but it's hard to forget solid E's all around. E+ rating here as Drake Maverick pretty much addresses Buddy Murphy's attack on Cedric Alexander and talks about how he was disgusted about it, but how Buddy Murphy has been impressive and that he was going to give Buddy Murphy a Cruiserweight Championship match at the Greatest Royal Rumble event in Saudi Arabia. But Cedric Alexander, Buddy Murphy apparently did not meet the 205 weight requirement, and it shows a little video recap of him getting weighed in. And it showed him at 207, I believe it was 207.5 pounds. Buddy Murphy was like, oh, well, give me an hour and I can work it off. And Drake Maverick was like, you had to do it by now, so you're not going to be able to. But you can, try next week pretty much. And that's that. And then, of course, he announces next week that there will be a gauntlet match to determine who will face Cedric Alexander for the Cruiserweight Championship at the Greatest Royal Rumble. The one thing that really kind of threw me off guard in this angle here, to be honest. So Drake Maverick, he says Buddy Murphy can't have his title shot because he is, above the weight limit. Thus, he gives a week for a gauntlet match to decide who will face Cedric Alexander. All right. But Buddy Murphy could reach the weight limit next week. And if he reaches the weight limit, why does he just not get the title shot then? If he was originally just going to get the title shot, but he doesn't because he doesn't, meet the weight limit, or he's too heavy, pretty much, he's above the weight limit, I guess. If he brings himself down the weight in the next week, then he should just be given the title shot, and thus making a gauntlet match pointless, unless you're going to throw him in it, but pretty much saying, well, you lost your chance when you lost, you gained the weight, pretty much. But either way, it gained heat to the Buddy Murphy-Cedric Alexander feud. And Drake Maverick putting in some work. A very awkward picture, but his other picture was god-awful with a dumbass Band-Aid on his forehead and everything. So it's the best I can do. And he looks like a GM in it, so I just wish his smile didn't look so forced. All right. E+. Let's keep it going. Look, we're moving up, guys. E+ rating here. Wow, this match did better than the match with Mustafa Ali and Daivari. And this match has two no-name jobbers named Aiden Chambers and Douglas James. By the way, these are not the two guys who fought the Brian Kendrick and Jack Gallagher on 205 Live. They're just two random jobbers, but I just picked them up. They kind of looked like them, to be honest, but I figured, I'm not going to put that much thought into, the jobbers. Jobbers are just jobbers. They're there to just be used. So either way, we have an abysmal match here as the team of Jack Gallagher and the Brian Kendrick go over our local talent, Aiden Chambers and Douglas James. In 4 minutes, 12 seconds, when Brian Kendrick defeated Douglas James by submission with the captain's hook. Gallagher is getting better at his gimmick. Apparently this match cooled the crowd again. Not sure how. I don't believe the crowd was ever hyped up at all. Brian Kendrick, with the best in-ring performance of the match, had a solid D. Jack Gallagher with a D-. Douglas James with an impressive solid E. And I say that because, remember, Arya Daivari and Mustafa Ali both just had an E and an E+. So Douglas James being an enhancement talent is pretty much on the same bar as those guys. And Aiden Chambers with an F+. Chambers and James did make the best of their appearance here tonight, as Aiden Chambers improved in rumble, technical, and performance, and Douglas James improved in rumble and performance, while Jack Gallagher, the one person who works for us, also made improvements, but only in performance skills. So, all right. We then move on to a solid E rating here, as Dasha Fuentes is back, and this time she is backstage interviewing Mustafa Ali as she gets his reaction on Buddy Murphy not making his weight. He's a little shocked by it, but, you know, he pretty much goes on to say some dumbass stuff about how Cedric Alexander, you know, he's pretty sure Buddy Murphy's going to meet his weight again, and Cedric's going to want to get his hands on him. But, you know, when opportunity strikes, you know, he pretty much goes on to say how he's going to win the gauntlet match next week, and then he'll face Cedric Alexander at the Greatest Royal Rumble, which, honestly, it could happen. I'd say it'll either be him or Drew Gulak, but I think it'd be Mustafa Ali, because, you know, they just did that at WrestleMania, and, you know, I don't want to be that guy, but, and put Mustafa Ali in that basket, but I feel like that's just what WWE's going to do. I mean, look what they just do at Jinder Mahal. So I feel like Mustafa Ali is kind of going to be pushed upon them, because, like, hey, look, doesn't he kind of look like you guys? As racist as it sounds, but, you know, I could be wrong, and maybe I'm not giving WWE enough credit. I know they're getting a lot of slack for the whole women not going to be in Saudi Arabia, but that's kind of a touchy subject there, too. I mean, you know, Saudi Arabia and their laws, I don't want to get too much into it. I'm not agreeing with anything that they're doing, but at the same time, you know, WWE's, you know, kind of in a rock and a hard place there. All right, moving on. Speaking of that, Saudi Arabia, I don't believe, is in this game. So it's going to be kind of hard when I book the Greatest Royal Rumble. I'm not exactly sure what we're going to have to do in there. I don't believe Saudi Arabia is in this game, so I'll have to, like, book it over in Europe or something. Like, the closest thing to Saudi Arabia, I guess. And there's no India either or anything, which is surprising. That'll probably be added in the next game with more, you know, worlds being added. A solid E rating here as we get, you know, a little bit of hype as we see the Lucha House Party, LHP, Gran Metalik, Lince Dorado, and Kalisto all warming up for their match along, you know, and then we get another camera shot, this time of Hideo Itami and Akira Tozawa warming up for their matchup. So there we have that solid E as we head into our main event. But before we jump to the main event, let's move on. We have yet another E-rated segment here, as this time with Drew Gulak backstage, as he addresses pretty much Mark Andrews and talks about how he decimated him or whatever, and then how if Tony Nese wants to, you know, get in his way, he'll just take him down alongside the entire 205 roster, because he wants to add the Cruiserweight Championship to his waist, and he plans on doing that after winning the Gauntlet match and going on to the Greatest Royal Rumble to become the Cruiserweight Championship. And pretty much he ends it by saying something like, if you cross me, you're going to tap out, or something like that. So Drew Gulak has been one of the shining stars on 205 Live, from what I understand. I've enjoyed his work from what I've seen so far. And to me, it's kind of interesting, because when he was originally booked on 205 Live, he was like the jobber of jobbers. Like, he was the one that always put in people over. And through personality and charisma, which in my opinion is the most important thing, some people look at the wrestling ability as the important thing. I think the charisma and personality is what gets people over, because without that, you know, anybody can be a good wrestler. Anybody can, you know. You can make the argument that some people aren't, you know, coordinate enough or whatever, but if you put enough work into your craft, you can be great at it. But not everybody can have a great personality. Not everybody can have a great, you know, charisma, you know, be charismatic. That's something that, you know, is just kind of there, or it's not. I kind of lack it myself, I feel, especially when I wrestle, but it's something I do feel, you know, you inherit over time once you get a little bit more comfortable as well. And I feel like that's what happened with Drew Gulak. He was allowed to show his personality more. It got over. He was getting more comfortable because it was getting over, and he was allowed to show more of it. So in a way, the one thing that Enzo Amore did do for 205 Live is he helped get Drew Gulak over. A lot of people look at the negative. Not many people look at the positive. All right. So this is going to be interesting. The main event. This one's going to be interesting because I went ahead and, you know, of course, with 205 Live, I like to, you know, up people's pushes because they're viewed as, like, you know, for instance, Cedric Alexander is, like, the main eventer of 205 Live despite just being a mid-card talent. So, of course, I upped, you know, Grand Metalik and Lince Dorado and everybody else up to, you know, upper mid-card or mid-card status or maybe even lower mid-card, pretty much whatever was, like, two spots up. But these guys aren't really over. The only one that's really over, I think, is Hideo Itami and maybe Tozawa. Metalik and Lince Dorado, especially Lince Dorado, are not over. I do not think this match is going to do well. This match is a long match. I think it almost went... I think it is actually 20 minutes because, you know, at the end of the day, of course, I have to add on some things because... Add on minutes to things, I meant to say. Because usually I'm left with more minutes to book that WWE didn't book. Whether it was commercials or something... I still don't know what exactly is happening where the shows WWE books aren't lining up with the Total Extreme Wrestling shows. I'm assuming it's commercial or something. But like I said, this match I do not think will do good. I'll be curious. I'd be surprised if this got an E. I think we're going to have an F. I think this match is going to do bad. But it could have an E. I'd be surprised if it does good at all. Here we go. Okay, look at that. It proved me wrong. It didn't do an F. It got an E+. In fact, it did better than an E. There they go. E+ rating. I don't know how they did it. I did forget to take Kalisto off of their as their manager because I assumed Kalisto was going to join them, but he didn't. And I was like, oh, I got to take Kalisto off. And obviously, I never did because I'm an idiot. But yes, so we have a bout that had terrible wrestling and non-existent crowd heat. The Lucha House Party, which you see it says Grand Lince behind them. That's just because, you know, like the New Day and like Sanity and whatnot, there's three different variations of the team because you have Kalisto and such. And I can't fit Grand Metalik and Lince Dorado in there, so I had to do Grand Lince instead. So just answer that question before anyone asks it, if anyone would have asked it. But anyway, the Lucha House Party goes over Hideo Itami and Akira Tozawa in a Falls Count Anywhere's match because, well, because this was supposed to be a... tornado tag match, and there is no tornado tag option in the tornado tag option in the database. There's no way of making it either. I figured I can make the match. There's no way to say, hey, all four men are going to be in the ring at the same time. So I had to kind of like work around that, and I figured the closest thing I could do to that would be a falls count anywhere. Even though it isn't really a falls count anywhere and pretty much falls have to be in the ring, it allows both men to kind of be in the ring at the same time, I feel. So that was my workaround there. Anyway, 17 minutes, 54 seconds, Grand Metalik and Tozawa, defeats Akira Tozawa with the Springboard Dragon Rana. The way I had the match work out, and you can even see it in the booking details, because I wanted to see, not booking details, road agent notes, I wanted to see how it worked, is... Oh, damn it. I forgot to keep Lince Dorado strong in this, too. He should have been kept strong because he really, like, was the highlight of the match. Like, Grand Metalik was really getting his ass, you know, he kind of, like, sat out most of the match while Lince Dorado took a lot of the pain. But I forgot to do that. Either way, I had, of course, you know, two people. I thought Lince Dorado also was put over as a victor, but maybe not. Anyway, I had two people lose because pretty much the whole finish was... Grand Metalik and Lince Dorado hitting a flying move together at the same time on both competitors, and then 1-2-3 at the same time, thus giving them the victory. Ignore Kalisto because he shouldn't have been there. Tozawa's getting better at his gimmick. This match cooled the crowd, which, I repeat again, I'm not sure how you cool a crowd that was never warmed up. Tozawa, you know, used subtle mannerisms to hint at a future heel turn. There was at one point where I thought Tozawa was going to be like, no, like... Itami was like ripping the mask off of Dorado, and it like you could see Tozawa looking on in the background, and I thought he was gonna come over and be like, "Don't do that, dude. That's a bit far," and maybe they were gonna tease something there, but no, they kept it going. So I'm not sure if that means Tozawa is officially a heel. I think I will go along and have him keep teasing it because he's still kind of over with the crowd, so maybe they won't turn him. But I do think after this. Oh, wait, I missed my chance to turn Hideo Itami, actually, because he's not in the next segment. So next time I have Hideo Itami, I'll have to turn him. I'll say that this was like his official turn, but I missed it. Grand Metalik with an in-ring performance of an E+. Lince Dorado with a solid E, so he had the worst of the match. Akira Tozawa with a D-, and Hideo Itami with a solid D, the best of the match. Dorado is improving in rumble, flying, and performance skills. Tozawa is improving in rumble and technical and performance. And Grand Metalik is improving in rumble and technical as well. Itami, the only one to make no improvements. And then finally, we end off the night with a Lucha House Party celebration in the middle of the ring as Kalisto, Lince Dorado, and Grand Metalik with some weird-looking maraca, shaky things. I don't know. It wasn't a maraca, like, in the sense where you shake it and, you know, it makes the noise. It has, like, this weird spinny thing on it. Like, you shake it and it spins around and makes a noise. I don't know. It was weird. Either way, they celebrate with a solid E, and I'd imagine this show got an E rating. Yeah, look at that. Solid E rating for the show, to be expected, to be completely honest, because, I mean, what were you expecting? I mean, every match, every segment from pretty much minus three, which got an E plus, was an E, so there you have it. Solid E show. Apparently, Lince Dorado was slightly overused, and the crowd wasn't happy because they expected more angles and interview segments. I don't think we were getting dinged. I thought we were fine in the criteria. I don't remember seeing something where it said like, oh, you had this too many of this or whatever. I must have missed it, but either way, I wouldn't have changed it because there'd be no reason to change it. Hey, wait a minute. Big Cass is dating Carmella? I thought they broke up. Whatever. Either way, that's going to be the end of this, or this episode. If you guys have enjoyed, do me a favor, leave me a comment, like, and subscribe if you have not already. Don't forget to share this video with your friends, your Facebooks, your Twitters, your Instagrams. I don't give a damn. Share it to whoever you think would enjoy my content. It helps out the channel. Help your boy out, and I'll help you guys out in return by putting more content up. Like, that helps anybody, right? As always, I've got a Patreon page. I don't plug it enough, but I should plug it more often, so expect to hear that a little more often. If you would like to support the channel, you're more than welcome to. I should probably link it down in the description below, so if I don't remember, someone try to remind me. But, yeah, if you, like I said, if you want to support the channel, help me get a desktop computer so we can, you know, do some more higher quality things. Be greatly appreciated. But also, not required. Only thing I require is your viewership. And last thing I'd like to say is, if you're looking for some good content besides myself, you can always look down in the description below and check out some of my associates and check out their channels, their Twitches, and all that stuff. That's going to be the end of this, though. My name's been OMGWTF, LOLFTWBRB. I will see you guys for the Superstar Shakeup edition of SmackDown, which should probably be up around the same time, around 205 Live. And by then, we should be caught up. I am going to be making an update video here soon. So it'll kind of cover what's going to be going on in, next week, cause I'm actually going to be gone, but I'll cover that when we get to that. I'll see you guys next time. Have a good day.